that God created you to fly. Listen, don't you know that really you're too big for this planet? You were created for something bigger, something greater. And listen, you cannot get distracted by your right now that you forget your tomorrow. Chandler, remind him, Chandler. Talk to him.
If you ever wonder what heaven looks like, it's looking like me and you. And if you ever question what heaven sounds like, just let it feel the room. Can you help me say? Say if you ever wonder, if you ever wonder what heaven looks like, it's looking like me and you. And I'm wearing blue. And if you ever question
good morning, church.
Good morning.
Praise the Lord. Let's give them a hand. Go ahead and pray. We want to welcome everyone to the Sanctuary of the Messiah Baptist Church, 4500 West Adams Boulevard in Los Angeles, California. Now, we're going to get started with praise and worship with our music department. Welcome.
morning, church.
Good morning.
My name is Chase Bright, and today I'm going to be reading Psalm 143.
Yeah.
Hear my prayer, O Lord. Give ear to my supplications in thy faithfulness. Answer me, and in thy righteousness. And enter not into judgment with thy servant, for in thy sight shall no man living be justified. For the enemy hath persecuted my soul. He hath smitten my life down to the ground. He hath made me to dwell in darkness, as those that have been long dead. Therefore is my spirit overwhelmed within me. My heart within me is desolate. I remember the days of old. I meditate on all thy works. I muse on the work of thy hands. I stretch forth my hands unto thee. My soul thirsteth after thee, as a thirsty land. Selah. Hear me speedily, O Lord. My spirit faileth. Hide not thy face from me, lest I be like unto them that go down into the pit. Cause me to hear thy loving kindness in the morning, for in thee do I trust. Cause me to know the way wherein I should walk, for I lift up my soul unto thee. Deliver me, O Lord, from mine enemies. I plead unto thee to hide me. Teach me to do thy will, for thou art my God. Thy spirit is good. Lead me into the land of uprightness. Quicken me, O Lord, for thy name's sake, for thy righteousness' sake, bring my soul out of trouble. And of thy mercy cut off mine enemies, and destroy all them that afflict my soul, for I am thy servant. May God bless the hearers and doers of his word. Amen. Amen.
You may be seated. Now, it's prayer time. Now, I want you guys to pray for and with sister, our sister, Maya Williams.
All right, Maya.
Take her to the prayer request.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
We're thankful for our family, our friends. We all have a roof over our head. We all have clothes, shoes. We're all healthy. We all woke up this morning and come to church to come praise you today. Lord, I'm thankful to be alive. I'm thankful for my friends to be alive. I'm thankful for everybody else who's in this church to be alive. And I'm thankful for you delivering me, and I'm thankful for the pastors being here. I'm thankful for the choir, the music, everything that had happened in my life. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Let's give him another hand. That's not the church of the future, that's the church of now. Amen. 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 All right. We got three young men in the back, Christian, Kwame, and Aiden. Think you can use them next month.
Amen.
I'm volunteering them.
Amen.
Amen. All right. Okay, what time is it?
Offering
time. All right. I have the tithe of Reverend Bergeron, the building fund offering for Sister Booth, and the tithe of Reverend Frost. Amen?
Amen.
As the music department gives us some music ministry, we'd ask that you prepare your envelopes and accordingly. Amen?
Thank you.
Our Lord and our God, we thank you once again for this day, for this time, and for these offerings and tithes and devils that have been rendered for the service from your servants and for the service of your kingdom. Now, Lord, we'd ask that you would do what you will for the furtherance of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray and thank you. Amen. Following selection, all the youth will retire to the Sunday school in the nursery. Amen?
Amen.
All youth after this next selection. Amen.
Yeah.
Good morning.
Good morning.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be good and glad in it. We thank God for this opportunity to assemble once more and again for the purpose of worship.
Amen.
Continuing the theme that was presented to you last week, our scripture can be found in Mark chapter 8, verses 34 through 38. Mark chapter 8, verses 34 through 38. I will read the even, we will read the odd, we will read verse 38 together. When he had called the people unto him with his disciples also, he said unto them, Whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself, and take up his cross, and follow me. Church. What shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Church.
What shall a man give in exchange for his soul?
Together. Whosoever therefore should be ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he cometh in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. May be seated. One of you, this subject is the same, the cost of discipleship. Subtitle, the sacrifices and stands made in discipleship. Sometimes we need to understand that we must stand at the appropriate time for the cause of Christ. It is said that during World War II, the Germans entered a little hamlet, and a church service was going on, and it was well attended, crowded. And they drew their guns and entered the church and said, all of you so-called Christians, get out of here, we're going to kill you all. So people began to scramble to get out. And when he looked around, there were only just a few chosen people, Christians. And he said, now, let's have church. That was a thinning out in that little city. You have to be committed to the cause of Christ. And then Shakespeare wrote in Julius Caesar, a coward dies 1,000 times but his death, before his death, but the valiant taste of death but once. If you are afraid, you have a tendency to feel pain and suffering inside, anticipating what might happen. And you suffer when you are afraid of everything, when you don't know the outcome and you don't have enough faith to believe that God will bring you through, then you have a tendency to become very much afraid. And then the Hebrew boys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they would not fall down dead in the lion's den. Then you have Peter before the Sanhedrin council. Stop teaching and preaching Jesus. When you look at the Hebrew boys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, these three young men that had been taken from their homeland and from their homes and taken down into Babylon, and then the king Nebuchadnezzar made a decree that when the musical instruments began to play, that everybody was to fall in the presence of those passing parade. But these three decided that they would not fall. And when they were called to stand before the king, they said, O King Nebuchadnezzar, live forever. For we will not fall for your God. We will not worship your God. And we know that we are subject to be put in the fiery furnace, but let me tell you, King, even if we are put in the fiery furnace, the God that we serve is able to deliver us out of your hands. So they put them in the fiery furnace, and the furnace was heated 7 times hotter than it had ever been before.
Yeah.
And it was so hot that the men that put them in the fiery furnace,
yeah,
died. because the heat was so intense. And then they began, the Bible says it fell down. And I believe that they began to pray and saying, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God of our ancestors, we stand on the faith that you will deliver us. If our souls are required today, take them, but we will not bow to the King's God. And then they walked around. They were bound and the chains and everything was loosened. And they began to walk around and the king looked in. Nebuchadnezzar looked in and said, didn't we put three people in there? And he said, oh yeah, king, we put three in there. He says, well, I see a fourth one, and the fourth one looks like the Son of God. Let me tell you something. In the midst of your life, God will step in and deliver you. In the midst of your bad medical diagnosis, God will step in and heal you. When friends turn their backs on you, God will take care of you. You don't have to worry about anything. Though they put you in the fiery furnace and life circumstances causes you to be in danger, God will deliver you. Oh, let me tell you something. Those boys were brave boys. They weren't afraid of what the king was going to do. They weren't afraid of the fire. When you have that kind of faith, when you can face tomorrow, no matter not knowing what tomorrow will bring, no matter how bad it seems and how dark it is, God will bring you through. And then Daniel, the man who was told not to pray, King Darius sent out a decree that for 30 days there wouldn't be any prayers raised except to his God and to him. And Daniel heard the decree and heard that they had put the sudden on the decree and that the penalty was to be put into the lion's den. But Daniel said, the God that I serve, I prayed to him from the very beginning, and I know the history of God with my people. I am not going to disobey the God of Jerusalem, the God of Israel, the God that brought my ancestors across from slavery, from Egypt, across the Red Sea, and across the land for 40 years. I'm not going to deny him. I'm not going to turn my back on him. I'm going to stay with him. And when the decree came out, Daniel simply went home and went into his upper room. Got in the window, not in the closet, not in a closed door, in the window, and prayed three times a day in spite of what the king had said. And they said, well, Daniel is still praying, king, and he's praying to that God, and you said that he'd be put in the lion's den. Darius' heart was heavy, for he loved Daniel, and Daniel had done great things in the land of Babylon. He says, put him in the lion's den. His heart was heavy. The Bible says he didn't even sleep that night. He didn't want the musicians to come in and play music for him that night. He just sorrowed all night long, for he was about, in his opinion, to lose a friend and a valued ally. But then early that morning, he got up and walked to the den where the lions were, where Daniel had been placed. He began to holler, Daniel! Daniel! Daniel says, I'm here, king. I was able to sleep all night with the lions. When danger is all around you, and you began to call on the Lord, remember what he did for Daniel, he can do for you. I don't care how bad it is. Sometimes it just looks like there's no hope in our lives. And we want to give up. We want to turn around. We've lost loved ones, and we've lost our jobs. We've lost our security. Lost everything. But then remember Daniel and the lion's den. He just simply used a lion for his pillow and slept all night long. God will deliver you. Oh, there are sacrifices that you must stand when you are a disciple of the Lord. You can't behave like other people in crisis. When other people face disasters, they don't know how to react. But when we face disasters, we just simply say, Lord, have thy own way. Lord, I know that you have my best interest at heart, and I know that what you did for Daniel, what you did for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, you can do it for me. So Lord, I'm calling on you right now. Help me, Lord, deliver me. And what you did for David, what you did for all of the patriarchs of the Bible, what you did for all of the servants that worship you, Lord, do it for me. And let me tell you something. He turns to the tent here, and he says, you are my child. Come unto me, all of you that are laboring and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I'll give you peace that the world cannot compare anything to. I'll give you peace. storm. I'll give you a light when the doctor says that there is no light. I can do the impossible.
Yeah.
Oh, let me tell you something. When Daniel came out of the lion's den, it was not the end of what God had in mind. The very people that caused Daniel to be put in the lion's den, they found themselves being thrown in the lion's den. God will destroy your oppressors. God will, Lord, destroy your enemies. He will strike them down one way or the other. Or he says, I will make your enemies your footstool, and I will drive your foes to hell. You can oppose God's program, but I'm here to tell you that in the end, you're going to suffer great pain, great loss. You don't want to oppress God's people. You don't want to oppose God's program. For God's program is bigger than any program that the world knows. You can oppose the decision that the mayor makes. You can oppose the decisions that the governor makes. You can oppose all of the decisions that are made in Washington. But when you oppose God's program, he simply says, that's enough. You've gone too far. I've had enough of you. You have oppressed my people, and he moves you out of the way. Let me tell you, God will take care of you. Oh, there's no doubt about it. God will take care of you. God will never leave you nor forsake you, no matter what you're going through. And then I must talk about the disciples, the apostles. The difference between a disciple and an apostle, a disciple is one that's being taught. A student, that's a disciple. But when you have completed your education and your training and you are sent forth, you become an apostle, a bearer of the word that God has given you. That's the difference. The disciple is a student. The apostle is one that has been taught and ready to go. The requirements for an apostle, biblical apostle, is that you had to have been taught by Jesus.
Yeah.
You had to have seen him after the resurrection.
Yeah.
That's biblical apostle. Now we have apostles now, and pastors and churches, we have apostles and all this stuff, but they're using the dictionary meaning of it, one that is sent to justify them being an apostle.
Right.
But let me tell you something, to be called a Christian is enough. And to be called a preacher is even more, and to be called a pastor is more responsibility. So you have to be sent by God in order to stay in where God has placed you. It costs a lot to be a Christian, because sometimes you have to say no to things that your friends don't understand. When they offer you a drink and you say, I don't drink anymore. But I remember the time when you used to drink a fifth a night. I don't drink anymore. They said, well, no, I take this blunt. I don't smoke that stuff anymore.
Yeah.
What's wrong with you? I found Christ. Oh, Lord, that's one of them holy rollers now. They don't want to have anything to do with us now. Forget it. Go on about your business. People will leave you when you testify that you have taken a new direction in your life.
Oh, yeah.
God directs you, and God has your best interest at heart. God has never given us anything or required anything of us that was not in our best interest. God never asked anything that is impossible for us to do. And then in 2 Timothy 1:7 it says, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a power and a love and a sound mind. God doesn't have you afraid of anything. David says, though I walk through the valley of the shadows of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Though I walk the streets of Los Angeles and all these crazy people with guns are shooting, I'm in my house and people are breaking in my house. I'm in my business and people are coming in my business and robbing me. I'm not safe anywhere. The Lord says, I did not give you the spirit of fear. You don't have any trepidation with me. You just have to walk in the newness of life. You must believe that I can protect you and I will protect you.
Yeah.
You hear, I heard just yesterday of a car that was exceeding 100 miles an hour in Selma, and it hit a tree, it was cut in half, and the people survived. How do people survive when a car is torn in half and half is some several feet away and the other half where the passengers are, and they survive? Let me tell you, God protects us even against ourselves.
Yeah.
Some of us make bad decisions in life, but But still, God protects us because our ministry is not complete yet. You say, well, I should have been dead. Why? God's program in you had not been fulfilled. You got to live until your program is fulfilled. And so sometimes, strange things happen. People fall out of airplanes, and I've heard red stories of men falling out of airplanes and falling great distances and surviving because their life mission had not been completed. God's going to keep you here until your mission is completed. You may have cancer, you may have aneurysms, you may have diabetes, you may have hypertension, you may have cancer, you may have all these diseases, but you're going to stay here until your mission and purpose is fulfilled. And it's not always positive. Sometimes you stay here to pay for some of the wrongs that you've done. Oh, Lord, help me now. We want to talk about the positive aspect of us staying here, but sometimes we're here because of the negative things that we've done. And you have to pay a little bit here. You got to suffer a little bit here in order to get where the Lord wants you to be. We live by examples, and God uses examples to teach us how he can protect us. I don't care what you're going through. When I was a young man, I went to church one Sunday, and this preacher was preaching. And he said that these soldiers were in a foxhole. That's a hole that's dug, and the soldiers in there defending themselves and shooting. He says, this one soldier just kept ducking. And the man said, one of his friends said, why are you ducking? You can't duck the one with your name on it. He says, I'm just trying to duck the one that said, to whom it may concern. You can't defend yourself against what God has planned for you. God has a plan for all of us. And how did you get where you are? Because the sacrifices and stands made in discipleship. There were times in my life when I suffered untold misery. I wanted things that I couldn't afford. My lights turned off, gas turned off, phone turned off, sitting up in an apartment in the dark, couldn't even call home to get help. Not that I could get help from home, but I couldn't do anything. But then the Lord blessed me. And now I can turn the lights on now. It was the Lord working, not me. It was not my intellect. It was not luck. It was by the grace of God that I made it thus far on the way. I was reading just the other day, another one of my people I work with has died. I'm no better than he was, but God chose that time to take him. So what we've got to realize is that God blesses us individually. God has an individual blessing made for each of us. And if we obey and stay within his will, he blesses us and just keeps on blessing us. You got to keep on praying, my sisters and brothers. I don't care what you're going through. Find your way to a prayer room. The war room, the movie war room. You got to have a war room, whether your war room is in your car, whether your war room is in your shower, in your closet, in your bedroom. You ought to have a place where you feel the presence of the Lord. Mine is stretched out right here before the altar. When my burdens become so heavy that I just can't see my way out, I pray and the answer seems to be delayed. I stretch out right there, spread my legs, spread my arms, and talk to God right there. You've got to have a place where you can communicate with God and believe that your prayer is getting through. People are not going to make life easy for you. They're not supposed to. But when God says, come unto me, all of you, my burdens are light, my yoke is easy. All you got to do is step under here and let me protect you. Let me guide you. Oh, there's a cost of sacrifice with discipleship. People are going to walk out of your life when you become a disciple. People are going to lie on you when you become a disciple. Times are going to be hard sometimes. But some people think that by joining the church, being baptized, and coming to prayer meeting, and coming to Sunday school and reading your Bibles daily and praying daily, that life is supposed to be just a bowl of cherries. What they want, they're going to have. They're going to have a nice car. They're going to have a nice house. They're going to have everything that the Lord has promised. Let me tell you, when you join the church, that's when Satan gets on you. As long as Satan has you, there's no reason for him to make you suffer. It's when you turn around and say, for Christ I live and for Christ I die, that Satan gets angry and says, I'll show you now. Look at some of our great preachers of today. They were great. They had great congregations. They were on television. They were all over everywhere writing books, and you were buying that tape. You were doing everything. And now they are almost totally dropped out of everything because Satan lets you prosper for a while. And then he pulls the cover off of you and exposes you for who you really are. You can't deceive God. You can deceive everybody in here. You can have a persona that everybody says, that's a Christian, that's a Christian, that's a Christian. But God knows that you are nothing but a phony and a hypocrite. And eventually, Satan is going to show you and show the world who you really are. Abraham Lincoln says you can fool some of the people some of the time. You can fool all the people some of the time. But you can't fool all the people all the time. You can't fool God any time. For he's omniscient. He knows everything. Oh, you got to sacrifice and stand for what you believe in. You can't be afraid and be a Christian because you have the faith to believe that God can deliver you. I don't care what you're going through. I look at the Grand Canyon, and I saw that man walk across the Grand Canyon on a rope. That man had faith. Yeah. What his faith was in, I don't know, other than his ability to cross the Grand Canyon or a cable. Now, to me, that's downright crazy. I don't have that kind of faith in me. But I believe that the Lord tells me to walk across the Grand Canyon on a cable that I can make it to the other side. Because without faith, it is impossible to please God. And God is not going to ask you to be silly, to do things that you shouldn't do, things that are unseemly. Oh, to be a disciple means that you've got to be taught. But sometimes we need to understand that after being taught, we need to do something. What the Lord has done for you, and you've been tested, then you have a testimony. And you need to tell the world how good God is.
Oh, yeah.
And in the face of all that you go through, you need to let the world know how good God is. Yes. Let me tell you something. He's good. He's a company keeper when all friends are gone.
Oh, yeah.
He's a light in the midst of darkness. He's water in dry places. When you go to court and you don't have enough money to hire an attorney, he provides for you to have somebody that goes pro bono, and somebody steps in and helps you, and you say, oh, I was lucky downtown, I got a good lawyer. No, you didn't. The Lord prepared that lawyer for you. I was sick, and I went to all these doctors. They couldn't do me any good. And I went to this one doctor, honey, let me tell you, that doctor is good. No, God used that doctor to show you how to be healed. It wasn't a doctor that healed you. God does the healing. And when you are a disciple, you tell the world that God heals. God works miracles in your life, your physical life, your spiritual life, your faith life. He's constantly bringing about a change in your life. Oh, the sacrifices and stands made in discipleship. You got to stand for something. You can't fall for everything. You can't be popular, seemingly, and be in Christ's will. If the Bible says, be aware of the man whom everybody speaks well of. If everybody is talking about how wonderful you are, everybody's talking about how generous you are, everything is positive about you, the Bible says, be aware of that man.
Amen.
For he's wobbling. He's going this way with you, that way with him, and so forth and so forth. If you're walking straight, you're going to lose some people on the right, you're going to lose some people on the left, but at the end, you'll hear him say, well done, thy good and faithful.
Well,
that's more important than being popular.
Yeah.
Oh, let me tell you about Peter. And when they were brought before the Sanhedrin Council, they were brought not because of anything they had done wrong, is that they were preaching Jesus and him crucified. When you preach Jesus and him crucified, people don't want to hear it. When you talk about the wages of sin is death, people don't want to hear it. That's old fashioned. When you look at Osteen, and I can call his name, and these other great televangelists, they don't talk about sin. They tell you how you can prosper. They tell you how you can have peace of mind. They tell you all these things. But in the end, the wages of sin is death. And the gift of God is eternal life. You can have all the money in the world and still go to hell. Because you cannot buy your way into heaven, and you cannot buy your way out of hell. Oh, let me share this with you. That was a rich man in the Bible who God had blessed abundantly. He had all these bold barns, and he reaped a bountiful harvest, and these old barns were sufficient enough to hold what he had gained. And he tore the old barns down, and he built new barns. And then he sat back and said, "So, take it easy. You have enough for a whole lot of years now. You don't have to work next year. You have to work the next 2 or 3 years. You got enough to live on." Death came and said, "Tonight. You come with me." Yeah. Then the Bible says, who do these things pass on to? Well, you don't have them anymore. You can sacrifice for money. You can sacrifice for prestige. But who do you go to when death knocks on your door? You got to spend eternity somewhere. Well, if there's a heaven, and people don't want to hear you talk about hell, if you just talk about heaven, don't you know that heaven does not have any significance if there's not a hell? There has to be a hell as an alternative to heaven. Yeah. If everybody's going to heaven, we're here for nothing. Yeah. If everybody's going to heaven, I don't need to be here. Because you're already going to heaven. Yeah. This is the highway that should lead you to heaven.
Yeah.
Oh. That the wages of sin is death. Inflation has affected every area of our life. But inflation has not touched sin. The wages of sin is still death. Oh, somebody say, "Hey, if you want to." Your gasoline's gone up. The price of cars are gone up. The price of real estate's gone up. The price of food is gone up. Everything is gone up. But the wages of sin is constant. From Genesis to Revelation to today, the wages are the same. Oh, when Peter and the other apostles stand before the Sanhedrin council on their second arrest, they said, "Well, didn't we tell you not to be preaching and teaching in that name of Jesus? Didn't we tell you not to preach no more? Why do you keep bringing that man's name up, and he's dead and gone?" They simply said, "The God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom ye slew and hung on the tree. You killed him. You did everything you could to stop his ministry. You nailed him to the tree." And in Deuteronomy it says, "Cursed is he that is hung on the tree." He took the curse of us, and he took it to the cross with him, nailed it to the cross. But let me tell you something. He didn't stay dead. You meant to stop him. But look, we're standing now. The 12 of us are standing now, declaring that he lives. Because how can we do anything except we heard and we saw what he has done, and how can we help but preach the gospel?
Yeah.
How can we help but tell the world what has happened, what has really happened here? And Peter says, it's better for us to obey God than to obey man.
Yeah.
For God has a reward that supersedes all of the rewards and accolades that the world can bestow upon us. We have life eternal. And then Paul Peter says, "I'm going to preach. I'm going to preach if I have to preach in the upper room." But thank God that the day of Pentecost, we went out of the upper room, and we went on the streets, and 3,000 were saved, and 5,000 saved, because the preaching of the gospel is foolish to those that don't believe. And it is a way of salvation to the other that believe, and it edifies us. Somebody wants to know, why do you always close your sermon when he got buried on Sunday morning?
Yeah.
Because without talking about the resurrection, we have not preached the gospel.
Come on, preach up!
The gospel in times like these, when people are losing everything, don't have enough of anything. You got to tell them that Jesus is the supplier of all that you need, according to his riches in glory. Let me tell you about this. Jesus,
That little baby that was born in Bethlehem of Judea, born in a stable. He was a king, should have been born in a palace. No, but he was born in a stable. Uh-huh. There was no midwife to take care of him. There was no one to take care of him. Only his earthly father and the animals were in that stable. Well. He was born and placed in a manger. Grew up like every other child. At the age of 30, walked down to the Jordan and was baptized as John the Baptist. Went off in the wilderness and stayed there all of those days, those 40 days and 40 nights. And didn't eat nor drink water. Somebody says it's impossible to live without water for 40 days. With God, all things are possible. The question is, anything too hard for my God? Let me tell you, he walked around, came down, and chose 12 men to be his entourage. And then one was a devil who would deny him. One would betray him. One would even go along. And let me tell you, out of 12, three of them were questionable at the time. But then early one Thursday morning, he sent Peter and John, James, into Jerusalem and to get a sacrifice to bring it. And they shared the upper room, the Passover, in the upper room. And then toward evening, he dismissed Judas to go and complete the negotiations for the betrayal. And then he took the water and took a towel and wiped their feet and washed their feet. And then he said, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. He could see the suffering that they were going through. And he says, don't worry about me. He says, where I am, there you may be also. But that was a promise in there. He said, Lord, we don't know where you're going, and how can we know the way? Jesus says, they sing a hymn, and he walks out and starts up Mount Calvary, going up to Mount of Olives, and he gets to the Garden of Gethsemane, somewhere between there, and he says, I want y'all to stay here. I want the 9 of you to stay here. Peter, James, and John, come on up with me. I need you to watch with me and to pray with me. And he walks over to the rock called Agony, drops his head on the rock of Agony, and begins to weep. And said, Father, if it be thy will, let this cup pass. Going back and find Peter, James, and John asleep. And then he wakes them up and says, can't you watch with me just a little while? Can't you be with me just a little while? Goes back to the rock and cries some more. Comes back and finds them asleep. Then he comes back the third time, and here comes Judas, one of his beloved disciples coming that has betrayed him. And they try to put their hands on him, and they all fall back, for you can't touch Jesus until he wants to be touched. And then he subjected himself and permitted himself to be taken and led down from judgment hall to judgment hall. And sometime early Friday morning, they took him out of the hall of judgment and led him out to Via Della Rosa. And he walked toward Calvary. He couldn't walk all the way. He was physically unable to complete the journey. And then they found somebody that looks like us and said, take this cross, boy, and you carry the cross to Calvary for this man. And when they get to Calvary, let me tell you something, anybody could have carried the cross to Calvary. I could have carried the cross to Calvary, but I could not be nailed to the cross. I couldn't be raised on the cross. I couldn't be taken off the cross and got up early Sunday morning. He got up. Sure, he got up. He got up and declared, I have all power and power in my hand. I have all power. Let me tell you something, I don't have limited power. My power is unlimited. If I remain in the discipleship of his, I know that when this life is over, and Job says the skin worms have eaten the skin and eaten all of me, yet in my flesh I will see God. Oh, faith and faith of the sight of the Lord.
That's the gospel. As you all stand, maybe there's one that recognize they need a Savior.
In times like these,
you need an
anchor. Be very sure.
Here he comes.
Sometimes we would drop that anchor and it would be in the sand. And when the winds and the tides began to increase, the boat would just drift. But then when we would hit something solid at the bottom of that ocean out there, the boat would stop and stay there. You've got to make sure of what you're hooked on to. Some of us are hooked on to dope. We're hooked on to women chasing, men chasing. We're hooked on adultery. We're hooked on everything. But you need to be hooked. On Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you.
Good morning, Pastor Jones and the church family. We have Christian. He said he's come to just rededicate his life to Christ, and Abel's just coming down to camp. We have Sister Jacqueline Clark. She wants to become a member of the church. She says she needs to be baptized because as a Catholic, they don't baptize their children. Amen. So she wants to be baptized and become a member of Messiah. Join us.
Praise the Lord. Okay, Sister Jacqueline, did you want to say something?
Thank you.
Clark talked to Reverend Frost and I last week after you had preached again, Pastor Jones.
Amen.
And of course, after
Clark.
Her husband came down. So she wants to join. She wants to be baptized. Amen.
Amen.
So we need a motion, Brother Simmons.
Pastor Jones. Members of the South Baptist Church, our membership in Jackson State, Jackson Clark has become a member of the South Baptist Church after finishing the members class, being baptized, and be given a right hand of fellowship to become a full member of the South Baptist Church.
Amen.
Second motion.
Yeah.
It's been properly moved and seconded that Sister Clark become a member here at the Messiah Baptist Church. Are you ready for a question? All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Amen.
Amen.
All right. We got the whole family. All right. Christian. Stand up.
Christian.
Man, you're way bigger than me now. You got a statement for us? Christian. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
And Aiden? Yeah. I know he just came with me, but he's doing his evangelistic
work. All right. Yeah.
All right. Well, good decision.
Yeah.
And pastor's preaching so hard. It's convicting everybody.
Oh, yes. Amen. Yes.
Well, almost everybody. Amen. All right. Anything else we need to do for each other? Pray for them. Okay. Let's pray for everybody. Right?
Yes.
Prayers all over the Lord. Heavenly Father, we come now thanking you once again for this opportunity
Thank you.
Lift these, your sisters and brothers up. We want to thank you for Sister Clark coming down. We want to thank you for Brother Clark coming down last week. We want to thank you for, like she said, Christopher Clark Sr., who labored here quite a number of years. And it's all in the lineage of Dr. Jones. We want to thank you for the entire family, Heavenly Father. For now, we know that you are the head of their lives. Then, Lord, we want to thank you for Christian coming down and rededicating his life. For we recognize that you know all things work together for good to them that love the Lord, who are the called according to his purpose. Now, Lord, we'd ask that you forgive us all of our sins and that you cleanse us from all unrighteousness, that you created us a clean heart, and renew a right spirit within us this very moment. And then we know there are many that are on the sick and shut-in list, and we're just lifting them up to you as well, Heavenly Father. We continue to be your humble servants, and we thank you for all the reminders that you continue to give us. But more than anything else, we thank you for Jesus Christ and his blood shed on the cross that faithful day on Calvary's mountain, that we could continue to walk with you and talk with you and lift up all our prayers and supplications. Now, Lord, we just ask that you would continue to bless each and every one of them, individually and collectively. And for that, we give you praise and honor and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
everybody's got to go to new members class, all right? Yeah. That works.
I just want to say that it's good to see the church give life and birth. It's good to see it increase. We thank God for all of you coming this morning and worshiping with us. I want to thank all of you that participated last week after church in supplying funds to complete the fellowship hall and the chapel. I purchased all of the material for the completion of it. The painting is almost finished, and we are going to persevere on. The fellowship hall itself needs painting, and so after that we will celebrate the Brother Webb and Brother Amartya with something that they deserve, a beautiful place to be remembered.
Amen.
And so I see I.O. is here this morning, attorney at law, Esquire. And to hear his family here this morning, it's good. Deborah, it's good to see you smiling like that. We want to recognize those two men who paid dearly. As I told Katie, I used to watch Stephen Webb give so much money away, it made me nervous. And what Sam gave to these members of these churches for his money, advice, doing free income taxes and all that stuff. You go up to his office and he would be leading people to Christ, teaching them and leading them to Christ. And so these men are worthy to be honored by this church because of their contributions to the furtherance of the kingdom of God. So we're going to do that. That's the fourth Sunday in July, is that right, Sister Webb? She can't hear me. The fourth Sunday in July, and we're going to, at that time, dedicate the classroom in the memory of Sam and Deacon Webb. So we're going to have a good time on that Saturday because the laymen on the Western Baptist State Convention will be meeting here, and they can be witness to it because they took the name Ernest Webb as their calling card for their annual luncheon. So we're hosting it, and yours truly has been asked to speak. So I don't know if I'm worthy or not, but we're going to have a good time that Saturday.
Amen.
So I'm asking all of you, please come out on that Saturday. You got the 4th of July, 4th Sunday in July. So get your tickets. As soon as Sister Webb has the tickets, we're going to purchase those tickets. We're going to show up as a church to support the memory of these two deacons who paid so much.
Yes.
If there be nothing else, you want to do this?
Okay, would all of our visitors please stand and receive the welcome? We want to welcome you and thank you for coming. Would you like to at least tell us who you are and where you're from? Spot 5211 West Adams as the Woman of the Year by Isaac Bryant. and I was with her. She is, Dr. Willis is the chair of Citizens for Reliable. What are these folks called? Anyway, they get vetted. They run for political office and they get vetted for the offices that they're running for. So there's a whole slate that her organization puts through a rigorous questioning to determine their reliability as well as what their intents are. And they run from everything, including the assembly offices, even the council people, and there's a slate of judges that work with the juveniles and the families that are displaced and have, once again, the problems with this, that, and the other, including substance abuse and what have you. And they are all very committed to trying to do the right thing instead of putting folks in jail, trying to get them help. Amen?
Amen.
So anyway, if you can attend, it's right down the street at the gathering spot, 5211 West Adams Boulevard, and it's happening right now. Amen?
Amen.
Is there anything else? If not, would you please stand? Let's sing at the church and say amen. You dismiss. Henceforth and forevermore. And the saints of God said,
Amen.